Welcome to another edition of Journey of Hope. Exciting stories of real people on their journey through life. Our special guests today are from Arizona, James and Jane Skinner. Glad to have you both here. I want to learn a little bit about you. People from all around the world are watching this program. And want to learn a little bit about you. First of all, where you're from. Why don't we start with you, Jane? Where are you from?
Originally. Originally from Indiana.
From Indiana.
Central U.S.
Okay. And Jim, where are you from?
Well, I was from outside of New York City, about 50 miles north along the Hudson River.
Okay. And where did the two of you meet?
We met at a business conference.
You remember exactly where it was?
I certainly
business
do.
Business conference?
The Concord Hotel.
Where?
In the Adirondacks, north again of New York City, but south of Albany.
And what kind of a seminar was it?
Well, it was a big conference, 3 or 4 days.
Okay.
And Jim was director of admissions at a college, and I was a guidance counselor. And
also in a school?
Mm-hmm. And okay. We learned about each other.
All right. It's amazing what the education will do. Okay.
Yeah.
So, you're originally from New York, and you're originally from Indiana, and you get acquainted. Where'd you have your education?
Okay, I went to a small Lutheran college in central Pennsylvania, Susquehanna University. It's one of four Lutheran colleges, universities in Pennsylvania. Then I went to Bucknell for graduate work in counseling. And then I got a master's degree at Bridgewater State University in Massachusetts.
Okay, so what was your master's in the second time?
College administration.
College administration.
Mm-hmm.
First one was in counseling.
Yes.
Okay, where did you get your education?
I went to Michigan State, undergraduate, and then I got a master's in English. I was a teacher for a few years, and then went on and got another master's in counseling.
So both of you got two master's.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Great. And what was your second master's in?
In counseling,
and
I became a guidance counselor in high school.
All right. So, Jim, tell me a little bit about your background. You were in missions, you were in education, but tell us about the colleges where you were, because you got a very interesting background.
Okay. Well, I was undergraduate admissions at my alma mater, Susquehanna University. And then from there,
That's the Lutheran school.
That's a Lutheran school,
okay.
Correct. And then I went to Norwich University, which is the oldest private military college, and that's in Vermont. And then
that's a military school.
Military school, absolutely.
So how did you get into that?
Well, they needed a director of admissions, and my background suited them, so we got it together. And from there, I then went back to another Lutheran college in New Jersey. From there, I went to...
Still in admissions now? Or?
Still, oh, yeah, always in admissions.
Always in admissions, okay.
Right. And then I went to a woman's college.
Oh.
And that was an interesting experience, and I'm glad I did it, because it gave you a whole new feeling about women's education. And
was it a four-year school?
It wasn't then. It was a two-year school, and now they've added four-year programs, really grown.
A liberal arts?
Liberal arts and... At one time, some secretarial programs. And we went stopped in there when we were back in the East Coast this fall and really saw how much growth there was. And then from there, I went to the Massachusetts Maritime College, which there are five state maritime colleges in the United States: Maine, Massachusetts, New York, Texas, and California.
And maritime, what does that stand for?
All right, maritime is ocean-going trade. In other words, it's taking ships around the world and taking products from one country to another. 96% of what you wear or buy or put in your house or whatever has come to this country, been transported somewhere by a ship.
And so when you talk about maritime colleges, these are colleges tied in somehow with shipping?
Yes.
Really?
Right.
Okay.
They could be
And there's five of them, you say?
There's five state colleges, and they will work on port management. They'll be on the deck of a ship. What I mean is rising up to captain. They can be in the engine room of the ship. And so, therefore, they will take these ships around the world and then do that. Then I went from... at that, then I went back to Norwich and then came back to, actually on Long Island, the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy, which is one of five service academies, along with Coast Guard, Annapolis, West Point, and the Air Force Academy.
So it's one of five?
One of five.
And it's military?
Yes. You're sworn in to the United States Naval Reserve, just like you would be when you attend Annapolis. You get your pink ID card. You want to go on a military base and buy something, you can. If you want to go on standby and fly to Europe or Asia or wherever, you can do that just like anyone else with that military card.
So do you have a military ranking? I mean, are you...
My rank at the U.S. Merchant Marine Academy was rank of captain, which would be comparable to a colonel, let's say, in the Army or the Marine Corps or Air Force.
So now, something you told me I found very interesting. Apparently, when you graduate from there, that rather than being committed to one of the particular services, you have an option, and that's the only one where you have an option, where you can choose. Is that correct?
Yes, it's absolutely correct. When you graduate, you have a Bachelor of Science, you have a license to practice your trade, which is the maritime, and a commission in the service. And on the day of graduation, you can put your hand up for Army, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, Marine Corps. You can also go into NOAA, National Oceanic Atmospheric Administration, go into the CIA, the FBI, the DEA. You can go into all these different...
Multiple options,
and that's why many have called the Academy the Options Academy.
Wow.
Because you know, it's great to be at West Point, be a West Point grad, but I know where you're going. You're going in the Army. There you are.
That's it, cut and dry.
That's it. It's right there. So this gives you a lot of options, and this midshipmen upon graduation take advantage of those options. And of course, the other side of the coin is to use your license that you've gotten, either deck or engineering. Deck means you're going up for captain of a ship. Engineering, you're going to be a chief engineer of all the engines on the ship, and go to sea. And any one of these commitments, going to sea for 5 years or going in the military for 5 years, it's the same 5-year commitment that you would have to make at the West Point or Annapolis or any of the others.
Oh, that's phenomenal. Well, I found it very, very interesting to learn a little bit more about Merchant Marines, because I've only heard about them until we began visiting and discovering. But I can tell he is a man that's always in charge, always in control. And then something happened here in the last... You guys have been together for how many years, did you tell me? You got
27 years.
You celebrated an anniversary here.
We did.
Yeah.
Yes, we did. As well as Christmas at your house.
Had Christmas at our home. That's right. Uh-huh. Well, now, tell me what happened here a few months ago, that you're going along, everything's fine, both of you have been in good health, never had any problems, although you did have a little hiccup there.
That's right.
What happened?
Well, I had a stent. I needed a stent in my heart. And we reacted very quickly to it and had it taken care of. And
where were you?
Got beyond it. We were home.
We were home.
In Prescott.
In Prescott.
But
Arizona.
We went to Phoenix.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So, and it was just a little thing like a stent. How did it affect
you? That's right. Well, it didn't.
It didn't.
No, we went on with our
lives. A little bump in the road, and you're going to take care of it and move ahead.
And that's how we feel about this, too, really. We did a lot of investigating.
He found out he had cancer.
Yes.
Okay. And what was your first impression when you find out that you had cancer? Again, was this a little hiccup, or was this a little bit more serious?
I think it was hard for us to admit at first, don't you? We didn't use the C word for a couple of weeks.
Yeah, we kind of stayed away from the C word.
And we're talking about prostate cancer.
Right.
Yes.
Right. And my father had prostate cancer and had it removed. So the fact that I might get this eventually...
It was the back of your mind.
It could happen. And so in 2009, my PSA went up and said, the doctor said, you need to go get checked, and a urologist in Phoenix, we went down to Phoenix, and they checked me with the biopsy work, and I had nothing. I was clear in 2009.
So they took a number of samples, and
right.
It came back, and it was clear.
Clear, right. So, you know, great, that's nice to know. But then my PSA went up again. They said, go back down to Phoenix and get it checked. We did. and they found that I had some cancer.
So they did another biopsy?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Yeah. Some guys like them. I don't know why. You've had them, at least two, apparently?
Two.
I don't think you like them.
I wouldn't say I like them, but, you know, having gone through it once, the second time, I really didn't notice it that much. And I was carrying on a conversation with the doctor.
Was it the same doctor?
Yes.
Same doctor. Well, I guess when you get through, you're a little bit more prepared, a little more relaxed and whatever.
Right.
If you get a good doctor, it really shouldn't be a problem. But many, you know, some men have had a terrible experience. So anyway, they come back with the news.
Right.
You have cancer. They found it this time. Right. How many spots?
Just two spots.
Out of 12?
Out of 12.
Out of 12,
yes.
Okay. Just a little bit of cancer.
Right. Yeah, it was a little bit.
A tiny bit.
Now,
okay.
Now, we didn't do
And that's how we took it at first.
Well, that's good. At first. But you weren't talking about the C word.
No.
A little
no.
problem with the prostate.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, just a little problem there. So that was in August, and we asked the doctor, said, look, we are kind of already booked for 3 weeks into Cape Cod on the East Coast, like to go back and see friends. What do you think? Can we go? And he said, yeah, you can go and do that, but come back and see me right afterwards, because they had a more analysis that they wanted to get done. And at that time, they told me what my Gleason score was and that kind of thing. And they talked about options, but you have to remember, this fellow's a surgeon.
Sure, right.
So he said, oh, we can do this robotically. I thought, my heavens, you know. I'm not even going to get the personal touch here. I'm going to get the robotic touch. So, but we had heard years ago from a friend at a dinner party where we constantly have this dinner group get together about Loma Linda.
And you're talking about years before?
Yes. Oh, yes. Yeah. Oh, I would say 7, 8 years ago.
Really?
This man came
at a dinner party.
At a dinner party. And we're very easy with each other, each of the couples, so we can throw anything out on the table, so to speak. And he started talking about it. And so we knew that existed. And so when...
Because he'd been here at Loma Linda.
Yes. Mm-hmm. He had been here and cured. It's been 10 years now.
But he's got the problem, not you, at that
right.
point.
Yes.
Yeah.
Right, right.
So it's
well, he had it.
Helpful information.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, he told us all about the great experience he had and why he came here and why he would certainly recommend anyone else. And so as a result, when it came up that, you know, okay, you got a little bit of this, he gave us Bob's book.
Bob Marchini's book.
Bob Marchini's book. Okay. And so we took that on vacation with us to Cape Cod and reading it out loud. Jane did all the reading.
So you read it. Okay, to him.
Right.
You're kind of sharing.
That's right.
On this little journey.
Yeah. And we were underlining things.
Were you?
You know, oh, yeah, we're going to make sure we want to
understand everything.
Understand it and be able to ask questions of the urologist when we went back to see him.
Sure.
And so we, you know, got through the vacation. I can't say that I was, you know, whoopee-doo all the time, because in the back of your mind, you're saying, I got to go get something taken care of.
It's there.
It's there.
It wasn't devastating news.
No.
It was a kind of an obstacle in the way. Well,
right.
That's kind of a healthy way to look at it.
Bump
I mean,
the
some
road.
People are devastated when they hear the words, you have cancer. They, you know, the big C. And of all cancers to be taken care of, prostate cancer is one of the easily treated ones.
Right.
Many different options out there, but most of them have some pretty serious side effects in contrast to the proton. So you got the book, you read the book on your vacation. You're the one that's reading it aloud. I can't tell you how many people I find that it's the wife that pushed the guy to get the biopsy, pushed the guy to get the book and, you know, read the book out loud. So you're reading the book, you're taking notes, and when you come back to Arizona then?
Yes, we came back to Arizona, went back down to Phoenix, and met with the urologist. And he, of course, one of the options would be removal, and we said no. And then he talked about the seeds. And we learned from Bob's book that really seed implantation may be okay if you get the most experienced doctor, because it's all about experience.
Pretty much
doctor dependent, yeah. You know, and so that wasn't a big one for us. We, of course, read up on IMRT, and we knew that Mayo Clinic in Phoenix had that, but they didn't have proton therapy, although by 2016, they will have built a cyclotron and have proton therapy.
An interesting point, you know, for many years, Mayo, and they're just world-renowned, was saying, you know, they could do the same thing as Loma Linda here with different equipment, same results. And then about 2 years ago, it came out with an article in the paper, they're investing almost $600 million in two proton centers. And you read the article and you think they've discovered the greatest thing in the 21st century. We've been doing it now for, we got our 25th anniversary coming up. But did he tell you that they were going to have it?
Yes, he did tell us. He was very
knowledgeable. But he knew we couldn't wait.
Pardon?
He knew we couldn't wait that long.
Right, yeah, there's no hope of, okay, delay it for 2 years, watch and wait or whatever. Even the gentleman who talked about it at the dinner party said, if you have cancer in you, why would you want to keep it in you? So go get it taken care of, Jim, and then not have to worry about it. So he talked to us about IMRT, of course, and he gave me a physical, thorough physical. He had all of my information from the urologist, including every sample taken, because he wanted to see it for himself.
Looked it all over carefully.
Looked it all over,
That's a good doctor. Mm-hmm.
Yes, yes, he was. He was very thorough and spent a lot of time with us. I mean, he was very nice, but he wasn't doing proton. And so we said, no, we're not going to stay. But that was just a chance to get a second opinion.
Sure.
And make sure we
Which is important for our listening audience to get a second opinion.
Right.
You know, it's very important.
Yeah. Well, you feel more comfortable that you're making the right decision when you make it. And so then we came out here and saw you first. That was the first trip. And we just...
Well, now, that's a very important point because you saw me first. You hadn't seen the doctor here yet.
No, nobody.
So you got in on the orientation, all right? Mm-hmm. We, for our listening audience, we have an orientation for new patients. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, the people in the orientation have already had the doctor. They've already had the consult. They're moving ahead. But you came out and got in on the orientation, and you didn't see the doctor that day.
No, no.
You just came for the orientation.
We came for the orientation to, one, investigate... You know, the program, what you had to offer, the environment we would be in, what was it going to be like to try and get a place to live? You're going to have to get a place for 8 to 10 weeks. And so that was, you know, good to come out and look at. Then we went back home, and then we got as much paperwork and all our material from the urologist sent to make sure it got here. Xeroxed and notarized and all the things you got to do. And then a lady called us, and then my nurse called me. Lori called, and we got the ball moving. So then we came out again and met with the doctor. Mm-hmm. And, you know...
Had your consult.
And had a consult, and that was it.
And did the pod.
No, I thought we did... the pod just before...
Maybe so.
Yeah, so we went back home. That's 5 hours. I mean, we're getting to really know I-10.
Like back and forth.
Back and forth, you know. So we went back home, then came back out when they told us to. Got the pod made and everything else, and then we were here.
Begin the treatment. All right, so you've been here, you've finished your treatments up, and you're looking back on your experience. What did you do while you were here? 9 weeks is a long time, but I know that the two of you didn't just sit around and just occasionally show up for your treatment once a day. What were you doing? You became a mayor.
Well, I did become a mayor of the Tuesday evening potluck dinner.
What is that?
Okay, that's a dinner of all the prostate fellas and get wives or significant others.
And others that don't, if there's occasionally
right,
some others
there could
that
even be alumni there.
Right, or some non-prostate patients.
Mm-hmm. Could
well,
be.
Yes, that's true. We did have one lady who had a brain tumor.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Right, so they come, they bring a potluck. We then have a usual program that evening. So it lasts from about 5:30 to top 7:30.
Yeah.
And it's a case of where you get around, chat, learn a little bit about each other and learn more about the prostate process, because you've got some people like myself. I'll be at the potluck tonight. Tomorrow's my last day. So there's some things I can talk to people about that don't know anything about it and help along the way. So it's really
it's a real good social psychodynamics that's taking place. And
a learning process.
It's a learning process, that's right. Yeah. So what are some of the other programs you took part in while you're here? Well,
we
and
did
you were
everything.
Very actively involved in the Tuesday potluck, too.
Yes.
What were you doing?
Yes. Well, socializing.
Okay, what
because
does that mean,
really,
socializing?
When new people come, they're a
so
little
he's the
hesitant.
Mayor, she's the greeter.
That's it.
She's out working the crowd.
That's
okay?
True.
Yeah. Shaking the hands and helping the new people feel at ease. Yeah, because
right.
that's a very, very important part. People come in there, and they're nervous.
Yes.
First time,
yes.
they're nervous. We've had people show up at the Wednesday night meeting, and they were told to go there. They're checking out Loma Linda. They've stuck their head through the door, and then they disappeared because they were sure they're in the wrong place because everyone was laughing and having such
right.
a good time, and they were expecting to find some cancer patients there. But so you're greeting the people. What are some of the other things that are going on that Tuesday night? There's a lot
well,
of stuff that's going on.
The conversation is the most important thing. And people really do get comfortable with talking about it. You might as well talk about it. It's what you're doing for 10 weeks.
See, you've heard me say over and over again, the treatments take place in gantry 1, 2, or 3, or the mm-hmm. horizontal beam. But healing is a process. Mm-hmm. And that Tuesday night that you're doing, you're talking about is a very important part of the support system. There's 14 centers here in the United States now. What is always going to separate Loma Linda apart from all the others, and they have them over in Australia, they have them over in Europe and Asia, they're talking about getting them in Australia. What is always going to separate Loma Linda is its emphasis on whole person care, mentally, physically, spiritually, and emotionally. Mm-hmm. And the parts that you're talking about, that's a very important part. The Wednesday night is another thing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And did you get in on the Thursday restaurant tour?
We went to every one.
You went to every one. Yeah. Again, it's that social psychodynamic that's taking place. Well,
like especially Wednesday evenings, professional speakers came in and
medical people
mm-hmm. and they spoke about nutrition and how it's affecting your body. There was two sessions. There was another session about immunology and how immune is our body, and the fact that we get older, we all know that we have less of an immune system. You get a scratch and it takes longer to heal. That's life. That's what's happening. And so it's been great to go to these programs on Wednesday evening, and of course the dinners at restaurants on Thursday evening.
Well, there are some people that even got into some cooking demonstrations, apparently.
Oh, that's true.
What happened? Tell us about
it. I missed Wednesday night.
Yeah, I
one
know.
Time.
I missed you at the Wednesday night meeting, but you were getting a cooking demonstration. What happened during that?
It was great because they talked quite a bit about the kinds of plant based foods that are more healthy. And Loma Linda is a very healthy place. This is one of the blue zones.
Yeah, well, that's interesting you bring that up. As you know, Dan Bettner wrote the article in National Geographic, then wrote the book Blue Zones. They went around the world looking for places where people are living to be 100 years or of age or older.
And in good health.
And they found 5. They circled it on the globe with a blue marker. That's where the term came from. And 5 places in the world, 1 in North America. And that little place in North America is where?
Loma Linda.
Loma Linda. If you want to live to be 100, move to Loma Linda. But some very interesting dynamics there. And you're right. It's listed there among one of the blue zones. So you went to the cooking demonstration. What other things did you take part in? Did you get involved down at the Drayson Center at all?
Yes, we did. We did. We enjoyed that. And we brought our bikes and our golf clubs. I mean, we had a good time while we were here.
So you were able to go golfing.
Jim felt wonderful the whole time.
And went biking. Did you bike very often?
Yeah.
Well, like, for instance, every day at least I would bike down it's about a mile down, a mile back.
This is why you're a cancer patient.
Getting cancer treatment.
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, bike down, get my treatment, bike back home, and then we biked other places. We didn't, not far from where we were, and it is in Loma Linda, where we lived rather, like 3 or 4 blocks, you could go mountain biking, and they actually had, you know, easy, medium, and hard or difficult trails. And one of the fellows in the gantry before me brought his bike, and he did go up and venture on the easy trail. He said there were guys on the difficult trail that would go off jumps and do cartwheel or whatever, a spin. He said, you know, I didn't even think about that. Getting up and down was good enough for me. So you can get a challenging group of trails here if you really want one.
Well, we've got people from around the world that are watching our program. And some of them have just been diagnosed. They've got some sobering news, some kind of a health issue. What would you tell them? Look into the camera as though you're talking to them face to face. And what would you tell them if they've been diagnosed? Now, you saw it as a bump in the road, but some are taking this devastating news. What would you tell them?
Well, first of all, you want to do some research. So, one, try and get on the internet, see what you can find out there. I would definitely try and get a hold of Bob Marchini's book.
That's if they have prostate cancer.
Prostate cancer in you. Right. And read that, because it'll give you a lot of insight, not just a proton treatment, but the other treatments and the pros and cons of them. And you might as well know about them, because you're going to have to go through one of them. Definitely, for us, proton treatment was the way to go because of the least after effects. And no effects, certainly, while we're doing it. None that I'm aware of, at least in my own behalf. So the biggest thing is, don't get over-anxious. This is curable. There are ways to take care of it, and you are going to regain your health and be healthy again and be viable, and that's what you want to be.
And we got people that are watching that have other kinds of cancer they found out about, and the counsel you gave there is also apropos of, you know, don't panic, look about, talk about different people, talk to people that have had the cancer, talk to other people that have had a particular diagnosis, and, you know, don't panic, but move ahead carefully but strategically going ahead. So for our listening audience, you know, Jim and Jane here are another example of people that have been confronted with cancer, and for them it was like a bump in the road. And people here often talk about like being here on a radiation vacation. And while they've been here, they've been actively involved. And for those of you that have just been diagnosed or had some news that confronted them that's going to be a turning point in your life, look to God. Put your trust in Him. Talk to some other people. Surround yourself with a family that loves you. Give God a chance, because He's got a wonderful plan for your life. Tomorrow is just the beginning of a wonderful chapter.